Greetings of peace and blessings, everyone. My name is Imam Soheib Sultan. I serve here as the full-time Muslim chaplain, and I direct the Muslim Life program here in the Office of Religious Life, which is housed out of Murray Donch, this building that we're sitting in here today. And this is a multi-functional room. We have our Friday prayers here, we have lectures here, and it's always switching hands between different faith traditions. So if this is your first time in Murray Donch, then welcome, and I hope it's certainly going to be many times that you come and visit us. When I came here 9 years ago, we established a series called Islam in Conversation. And the idea of this series is to bring together different academics, artists, activists to this campus from the United States and from abroad to engage in a wide variety of questions around Islam and Muslim societies and cultures and our contemporary world. And so today we have Dr. Jonathan Brown, and he is a professor at Georgetown University. And he is someone who is a really thoughtful writer and speaker about Islam, and especially about Hadith, the prophetic legacy of the Prophet Muhammad in particular. And among his books is Misquoting Muhammad, which is a really interesting book about the different ways that the legacy of the Prophet Muhammad has been interpreted. He has probably the most comprehensive premiere on an introduction to Hadith studies and sciences. It's an accessible text, in fact, so I encourage you all to read it. He's also written a very short introduction as part of that very short introduction series. So he's written a lot of really interesting books. Dr. Brown is actually our most often repeated guest. This is his third time in my 9 years at Princeton. We're always very happy to see you back. And part of what I really love about Dr. Brown is not only his thoughtfulness, but how much he's willing to engage with the audience and with the students in particular. And I say that because I want all of you to feel and experience this like your living room this evening, and that this is going to be a fun and intimate conversation, and that we want you to bring your whole selves, your thoughts, your ideas, your questions to the table. And we are going to start off in a very conversational format by putting forth a series of questions for Dr. Brown to articulate out loud. And the one who will be asking the questions and engaging with follow-up is our very own Zina Mubarak, who is a senior here at Princeton University, and she is majoring in Near Eastern Studies. And Zina is somebody who's been very active in the Muslim community and in the Muslim Life program. She used to be the vice president of the Muslim Student Association, and mashallah, she is coming to be her own in terms of thinking about really critical issues.
And she's from Washington,
D.C. area. And so, you know, that's another reason we thought this pairing would be great. So without any further ado, I want to give it over to Zina to start asking questions. And even though this is an intimate setting, we are using the mic in order for the audio to come up clearly in our recording so other people who are not able to make it here today can listen in. So I want to thank you all so much for coming, and I hope that we have a really interesting and engaging conversation. Thank you, Zina.
Thank you, Mamsi. So just to start off, so that everyone's on the same page, could you give us a basic definition of pluralism and talk a little bit about how we understand pluralism as it's going to be used in this conversation?
I got straight to the point. Pluralism, the term is a sort of rich history. I think it was first, pluralist societies or plural societies, the term was first used in the early 20th century by a British colonial officer named Furnival, in Burma, it was then Burma. And he talked about it to sort of describe this society in these kind of cities of Burma, Rangoon, and places like that, where you talk about how you have sort of Chinese and Burmese and Muslim and Malaysian, Indonesian, Indian people, and they're all sort of these different communities in the city, and they only mix sort of in the marketplace, and they have their own customs, their own traditions, their own dress, and sort of they're always just moving side by side, but not really interacting except in buying and selling things. And for him, that was a criticism. This was something that sort of he saw was made sort of a society that wasn't really a real whole society. Now, since that term is invented, it then comes on to, you could see it branching in two different directions. One is the kind of idea of glory, of, you know, celebrating diversity, which is a statement that's always used in the assumption that that diversity is always part of a unified whole, and not just a whole in the sense that people live together and under the same law and buy and sell in the same marketplace, but whole in the sense that there's actually a greater conjoining or unifying identity, a national identity, a belief in some common flag or ideology. So it's and the other kind of direction is to say, no, you know, pluralism really means that people have completely different identities and maybe nothing in common with each other except the fact that they happen to live side by side with one another. So pluralism is you know, it's a loaded term because it can be used to celebrate diversity within a unified whole. And of course, then you have this question implicit there, which is how much diversity can you really tolerate if you're talking about a unified whole? And the second is this idea of really just total diversity with a very limited unifying social and political framework. Does that answer the question?
Yeah.
Why not? Sounds good.
So I guess the second question we were going to talk about is, do we understand pluralism as a virtue? And I guess there might be different answers for the two different paths you described. And if we do understand pluralism as a virtue, what's the role of non-pluralistic traditions in that framework?
Okay.
Thank you.
So let's think about that. I'm used to giving lectures, actually answering questions. Difficult. I guess I would start kind of beginning with my previous answer, which is that it depends on what you think is good. What is your idea of the good? What are you pursuing in the end? The nation state, and we all live in nation states, is premised and really built around the idea of a common identity, a common ethnicity in the case of countries like France or Germany or the Netherlands or Italy. Some idea of this imagined thing of being French or German or Italian. And that comes with a certain idea about language and literature and values and history. In the case of the United States, it's rooted at least ideally in certain values, a certain belief about democracy and freedom and rights. Of course, that's not actually a reality for many decades and whatever, a century and a half, and still remains highly contested. But my point being that the nation state actually has a very hard time dealing with difference internally. Has a very hard time dealing with difference. And there's a number of reasons why that is, and this goes back to these two definitions of, or two conceptions of pluralism. If you think about that kind of Burmese society that this Fornival British colonial operative describes, you know, in some ways it sounds wonderful, right? So everybody's, it's like, you know, Mos Eisley spaceport in Star Wars, except no people getting their arms chopped off and stuff like that. Do people still know Star Wars, or am I people are just completing right now? So I mean, you know, we have this, you know, idea. It's a romantic thing, you know, this complete diversity and everyone's dressing different and mixing and all these languages and different foods in the street and stuff like that. And you know, it is wonderful to think about. But then you think about the idea of how do you, let's say that state then has to fight a war. how do you get a bunch of people to be willing to sacrifice for a polity that doesn't seem to actually have any shared identity or ideology? And it's no coincidence that the nation state really emerges in Europe at the same time as standing armies, at the same time as a large-scale colonial activity. And the idea of, let's say, being French comes into being at the same time as there being a massive French standing army that is going to follow Napoleon to Russia or to Belgium or to wherever. So the idea of a standing army and the nation state are really linked. Think about this. What will Americans fight for? There's a reason why, you know, when you go to, I can't always imagine this image of a sports game where you go to a football stadium and then there's, you know, sing the Star Spangled Banner and then, you know, these Blue Angels jets fly over or something. So the idea of national celebration and the military are strongly linked. And this is not a coincidence. It's something that emerges in the late 1700s and early 1800s in Europe. And if you think about it, if you want to have an army that is going to go and fight, a massive army where you're raising, you know, you're conscripting huge swaths of the young population, and then the society is devoting itself to total war, which is really something that begins with the Napoleonic Wars. And the whole society, war is not something that elites do anymore. The whole society is going to be involved in war now and suffer and sacrifice. You have to have something that's going to motivate people to do that, and that doesn't really work if you have this pluralist society where the only thing people have in common is they happen to live under the law and order of the local ruler, but otherwise they have no emotional connection to one another. So if you believe that a state has to possess some shared ideology that can move people, that can, you know, when you're at the football game and you hear the Star Spangled Banner, no matter who you are, you feel moved, and when the Blue Angels fly over, you feel moved. And when you watch Hacksaw Ridge, you feel moved, and you know things like that. And if that's part of the good of a nation state, that is not going to be facilitated by that what we might call really strong pluralism of the Burmese city. It is possible, and this is actually something you see in American movies in the 1950s. Which always these movies being made about World War II, and in each unit, because World War II, as you see from the movies, was fought by units. Each unit, there's like the Indian guy, American Indian guy, and there's the Polish guy, and there's the Yiddish guy, and then there's the Sarge. And the idea is that these guys are all, they're from different places, but they all, two things, they all love baseball, and they all love America. So there is a little bit of pluralism there, but that's really weak pluralism. Because what's different? Maybe the Yiddish guy eats latkes or whatever, and the Polish guy eats whatever Polish people eat, and the Italian guy eats spaghetti and talks about his mom's spaghetti and stuff. But otherwise, they're exactly the same. So that's a very weak pluralism, and that really can can coexist with a militaristic nation state. So it depends. My answer would be, it depends what you think the good is. If you think the good has to be tied to a national identity that can be mobilized for purposes of war and national defense, then strong pluralism is not good. If you think that sort of stuff is bad, and that people should kind of have a maximum ability to pursue their own, or to indulge their own identities and traditions, then pluralism is good. And by the way, just to remind you, there's a reason why the two great, very pluralistic multinational empires of the pre-modern period, namely the Austro-Hungarian Empire and the Ottoman Empire, there's a reason these states fell apart in the late 1800s and early 20th century, and then at least in the case of the Austro-Hungarian Empire, couldn't really fight effectively in World War I. The Ottoman Empire did fight effectively. Because it's very hard to engage in total war when your population has really limited notions of identification with the polity, with the empire.
So just a follow-up question to that. Do you think that the kind of strong pluralism you're describing in the second part of your answer requires communities to live separately from one another? Because in the Burmese example you were giving, you mentioned they only interacted in the marketplace.
Yeah.
And then, obviously, in a nation state, those shared aspects that you're talking about are what you get when you start mixing, you know, and going to the same schools.
I mean, I think it depends on what what we require for living together. You can imagine that. This is a really interesting case in the 1300s in Cairo and Damascus. So they would, we actually have, scholars would write down registers, and they'd have hadith dictation sessions. That, you know, a scholar would read a hadith collection, and a bunch of people would come in off the street, and, peasants, whatever, merchants, not just scholars, this huge audience, and they would write down the names of people who were in the audience, because that would then, they would then be in the chain of transmission. Every once in a while, there's actually like a Christian and a Jew in the audience too. So-and-so, Samuel bin Narhila, may God guide him, they'll say. So, but the point is, what I think is interesting is this is a case where here, even though these communities are living separately, they're interacting even on religious things. I remember in the 1000s in Baghdad, one scholar, Muslim scholar, is complaining because the Muslims are closing their shops on the Sabbath, on the Jewish Sabbath. So there are, people can interact in the sense that their cultures can mingle, they can affect each other. You can imagine them sharing holidays, sharing sweets sometimes with each other, or celebrations. But I think when we talk about living together in the sense that we mean today, I'm not sure if that's so possible in a kind of strong pluralist society. And by that I mean intermarriage, really strong kind of common friendships between people of different communities. I mean, this happened for sure, but I think it was an exception. I think that, for a community within this pluralistic society to retain its integrity, it has to be very insecure in a sense.
And then I guess, do you think that kind of insularity is possible in a modern context?
That's a good question.
By the way, I should add that it also depends if you're, so in, let's say, a Muslim state, let's just take the example of the Ottoman Empire or the Mamluk state of Egypt and Syria and Egypt from the late 1200s, mid 1200s to the 1500s. It depends who's in charge. So if you're the Muslims, then you're gonna have perhaps more interaction with non-Muslims than if you were not in control, in the sense that Muslim courts had non-Muslims coming and notarizing documents in the court, and they had Muslims would employ non-Muslims for various tasks. It was much rarer for a Muslim to be employed by a non-Muslim, like a Jew or a Christian, so it also depends where you are in the kind of hierarchy of the plural society. And then I forgot the question.
Just whether insular.
It's possible today.
Possible.
I guess you're Amish. There's always the Amish example, which is really interesting because one wonders to what extent it's really an option, or if it's just a sort of one-off case in American society. Is it something that you can really replicate? But then, and I don't know a lot about this, but you also have Orthodox Jews, especially in New York area, who seem to have their own world, as far as I know, but live quite accepted in the areas they inhabit. I think if that's sort of how you stake your identity, it's possible, but I think it's very difficult, and it's very difficult unless you really cut yourself off from almost all the technologies and media that are so pervasive in the society. I mean, if you start watching TV, then it's very hard to separate yourself from the society that TV depicts. If you end up being able to, if your best way to relate to other people is by Game of Thrones references, and that means a lot for how you conceptualize your society.
Can you talk a little bit more about the historical role of pluralism in Muslim societies? You've touched on it in a couple of different places, And more specifically, whether we have sources about the perspectives of minorities living in those societies and what those sources might tell us.
Yeah, we have a lot of sources about what minorities living in Muslim states thought. And, you know, not surprisingly, sometimes they were, you know, unhappy, and sometimes they were happy with being generally left alone. I'd say that from my reading, the group that is most consistently registering complaints, if that's the right way of putting it, is that it's actually not a minority, but a massive majority, which is the Hindu family of religions, let's just say the indigenous religious groups that inhabit India under Muslim rule from the late 1100s until the fall of the Mughal Empire in officially 1857. There's a lot of discontent expressed by, indigenous communities in India at various times. The irony is the Mughal, especially under the Mughal Empire, for those of you who don't know, the Mughal Empire is the Indian descendants of Tamerlane, i.e. Mongols, who take over in India, usually the date is, I think, about 1526. Real effective control is lost in the mid-1700s. Officially, they rule until 1857 when the British officially oust them after the Indian Mutiny / First War of Independence. Now, they rule in northern India, especially from Delhi and also Agra, and they, by the early 1700s, expand all the way into almost the entirety of the subcontinent. Okay. At the most, according to British census, I think 1875 census, the largest percentage of Indian population of South Asia was about 25% of the population. And so Muslims are a minority, they're a ruling minority. And so the irony is, despite the fact that there's a lot of discontent at various times by certain elements of the Hindu population. Ironically, this also the empire, the Muslim state, that relied the most on non-Muslims. So the Mughal army relied totally on Indian soldiers, especially from the Rajput caste of warrior princes and kings. They relied tremendously on them. They relied on Hindus for administration. They relied on them for almost everything, because the Muslims were not numerous enough to actually maintain the basic defense of the state. So that's the case, I think, is maybe you find the most rancor in my experience. I think, you know, with Christians and Jews in the sort of central lands of the Mediterranean, Iraq and Iran area, occasionally there were, you know, riots against Christians in Egypt, like in the 1320s. Occasionally there were riots against Jews, like in Granada in 1066 of the Common Era. But these groups flourished under Muslim rule. I mean, this is just a fact. And in fact, I think David Wasserstein at Vanderbilt University wrote an essay called How Islam Saved the Jews, I think it's an essay. Somebody look that up. I know some of you have electronic devices. And I think he also wrote a book on this, How Islam Saved the Jews. But what he demonstrates is that, you know, what we think about as medieval Jewish culture and the intellectual tradition, theological and philosophical and legal tradition of Judaism, the majority of it comes from Jews living under Islamic rule. And they were able to flourish. And then they were constructively influenced by their Muslim surroundings. So when you read Maimonides, he died in 1203. Somebody look that up for me. Look up to Maimonides. You know, when you read his Mishnah Torah, his writing, or his Guide to the Perplexed, this is it's as if he's a Muslim scholar writing. When he writes about theology, philosophy, even law, he brings in ideas of consensus or Ijma, which the theory is that he's really strongly influenced in law by a Muslim scholar. So I think these groups flourished under Muslim rule.
Can you talk a little bit more about the specific nature of the indigenous Indian complaints, or If you, yeah, like, that's pretty young stuff.
No, I mean, I could. It's just, it's pretty obscure stuff. I mean, I'll do my best.
Okay.
I mean, it's all, I mean, there's some very specific, so I think when, I don't know if this is getting, like, too into the weeds on South Asia, but I think when, so South Asian history in the context of Muslims and Hindus, it's oftentimes phrased as this battle between Muslims and Hindus. And the participants in these conflicts often characterize them as such. But I think it's much more, and this is not just my theory, I think this is the kind of general opinion of scholars, the kind of state of the field of scholarship, is that it's really just South Asian politics. And, you know, if someone rises up against you and then you defeat them, you go and you destroy their temple and you take their idols back to your temple. And if you're a Muslim, then you destroy their temple and you build a mosque there. And you take the bricks of their temple and you go and build a mosque out of it. And the Hindus would do exactly the same thing to each other. And if someone is your vassal and they're nice to you and they support you, then you patronize their temple. And if you're Muslim and they're Hindu, it doesn't matter. There's this British traveler in the 1600s who goes to Pune, where they have the temple of Jagannath, and he actually just, he sees the Mughal official like sitting there eating betel nut or whatever, he's eating like a big pot belly. And he's there to, you know, because they patronize the temple, and they, every year they give money. And so the very Mughal rulers who are seen sometimes as being these intolerant kind of orthodox Muslim oppressors, like Aurangzeb, Alamgir, died in 1707, he's also the one who elevated the most Rajput generals to high positions in the army. He's also sponsoring Hindu temples at the same time as he's destroying other Hindu temples. So I think we have to watch out that, you know, there's this one battle during the reign of Akbar the Great. He died, I think, 1605. He reigned from the mid-1550s to 1605. And he's having this battle, and there's actually, so a big part of his army is Hindus. And so one of the scholars, the guy, scholar who's writing this history, he actually goes and he decides he wants to go and do jihad he wants to feel like he's done this once. So he goes and he's got some arrows and he's shooting. And he asks the guy next to him, he says, how do I know I'm shooting at these, but I don't know if it's Hindu, if the Hindus that I'm shooting at are on our side or on the other side. And he says, the guy says, it doesn't matter if it kills one on their army, that's good. And if it kills one of our Hindus, it's not that bad. So, but then the same battle, there's this, one of the Rajput warriors goes and fights this, you know, bravely in battle. He's killing all these people and leading these soldiers. And there's this Muslim poet writes this verse of poetry. He says, today, you know, a Hindu bore the sword of Islam. So in one battle, you can see how complicated psychologically this is. You know, they're both very appreciative of this Hindu who's fighting bravely on their side, but they're also... doesn't really matter, they're all Hindus. But I think in this case, you see, the religious lines blur, and what really matters is whose side are you on? Are you on the side of the, you know, do you happen to be on our side or on the other side? And religion, in that case, doesn't really matter.
Thank you. And then...
Maimonides died. I can't look up Maimonides. Sorry, he was my former student. I shouldn't be critical.
So to bring us back to a more general question, how can we avoid engaging in moral relativism while trying to respect the views of others while living in a pluralistic world?
Oh, that's a good question.
So I think that, well, first of all, if to ask yourself this question, what's wrong with moral relativism? I mean, moral relativism is only wrong if you believe that there's some moral absolutes out there. Correct? I mean, and that's, by the way, that's not an assumption. Human beings don't drop out of the womb and know that they're moral absolutes. In fact, for most of human history, probably that would not be the assumption. The assumption is that you would have your community, your religion, your philosophy would have some understanding of morality is true, and other people are just completely out to lunch. Did you find Maimonides' death date?
Well, I was dead, so number four.
1204. So I said 1203. I was 1 year off. Is that your father? Looks younger. Is that your father? Looks younger than you. With my skincare regime here. So I think that's him. Because what we have to say is, what the question is how do we? The question isn't how do we not lapse into moral relativism. The question is, how do we justify moral absolutes? And if you were to go and, let's say, ask a random, let's say, intelligent American on the street, how would they justify moral absolutes? They might say something, well, that's something is common sense, or something is, let's say, human rights says something. Now, both of these traditions are not clearly justified, right? So common sense just means whatever one society thinks has been established as fixed points of inquiry and are no longer subject to debate. Or perhaps are actually subject to debate, but you don't have enough evidence to come up with at that moment. You just say, it's common sense. Things like human rights, this is a very new discourse. Really only emerges in full in the 1940s. And then is debated a lot in the Cold War. This is very interesting. I mean, that during the Cold War, the US said, human rights are like freedom of speech, freedom of political involvement, freedom of association. And the Soviets said, no, freedom of rights are freedom of, right to health care, right to housing, right to child care. The US said, no, those aren't freedom, those aren't human rights. So what you see is it's actually not at all a neutral, absolute thing that all human beings agree on. It's actually very clearly a product of Cold War disagreements. And then, if any of you are old enough to remember this, when did human rights really become an effective tool of international coercion is really after the Cold War ends, because then the debate's over. So my point is that even those things that we would point to, let's say America on the street would point to as ways of saying this is a moral absolute, these are not actually absolute. These are also culturally contingent. So I think the question, how as a Muslim do I talk about moral absolutes? Well, in Islam, and this is a very interesting element of Islamic law, which people don't talk about a lot. It gets mentioned a lot by Muslim scholars, but they don't very often theorize it. It's sort of always understood, which is the idea of what's called hukuk al-ibad. Hukuk al-ibad means the rights of the slaves of God. It basically means human rights. It means rights that people have because they're human beings. And they have this regardless of they're Christian or Jew or Hindu or Zoroastrian, right? Whatever. You would say right to life and physical integrity. So someone, you can't just be killed for no reason. Someone can't come and, punch you in the face for no reason without facing consequences. You have the right to property. You can't be deprived of property without reason. You have the right to dignity. You have the right to dignity. You can't have your dignity impugned without reason. And so these are the, sexual integrity. You have the right to your sexual integrity in the sense that your sexual being shouldn't be violated or accessed without reason. So these are actually core to Islamic law. And it comes up a lot in Islamic legal discussions when people talk about why a certain ruling has to be taken. Why do Muslim scholars have to take a ruling, this ruling as opposed to that ruling, or pick from this school of law as opposed to that school of law? Or why is a judge ruling in a case in this way? Because otherwise, the hukuk al-ibad will be lost. The rights of God's slaves will be lost. So for Muslims, I think, for me as a Muslim, I can tell you where my moral absolutes come from. They come from what Muslims derive from their revealed tradition, from the Quran, the Sunnah of the Prophet, from what they saw as first principles of reason. Now, it just happens to be that these overlap a lot with human rights. But if someone comes along and says, well, it's also a human right that someone should be able to get free refills at restaurants. I mean, in theory, someone could come up with that as a human right, because now people say, human right, you have a human right to your own gender identity. That was not a human right 50 years ago. That was was not a human right 20 years ago. So the list of human rights in the Western discourse of human rights is something that can be added to. And for Muslims, in my opinion, as far as I understand Islam, we can add to things that we think are good. We can say it's good to get free refills in a restaurant, or it's good to have certain understandings of the way people interact with society. But to say that we're going to say these are absolute rights that human beings enjoy because they're human beings, I think that would be impossible to say. And I mean, that's why, by the way, you know, you see disagreement between Muslims. The UN has this Declaration of Human Rights. I think in the 1990s, there was the Cairo Declaration of Human Rights. There was a Muslim version of that human rights. And if you look at where it differs from the UN Declaration of Human Rights, it is on things like issues of sexuality and stuff like that, where Muslims were so, we don't think these are human rights.
So if these human rights in Islamic context are absolutes, how do we understand the way they've changed over time? For example, with issues of like slavery, now a lot of Muslims would argue that Islam, you know, was trying to encourage abolition from the start, and all humans have the right to their freedom and, you know, control over their own body. But that was not how Muslims, or even a majority of Muslim scholars, viewed it, you know, in the previous century or before.
Oh, I guess you weren't kidding about no softball questions. So I think I have to answer this in an effective way.
You have some tea up there.
Thank you. It's not as nice as your drink. There was an issue earlier where I expressed discontent about how many tasty smoothie-like drinks were being drunk by audience members without me being drunk. When slavery is a very interesting issue, I was actually talking to other people about this at lunch today, but because today, if you're going to kind of use an argument to show how the kind of the rock solid fixed point of inquiry that no one can question is that slavery is bad. So when you're in a debate and you say, well, that's what Hitler said, or well, would slavery be okay then? Those are the two points where you can kind of win the debate, right? So no one's going to say Hitler was right, and no one's going to say slavery should be allowed. What I think is, it's an irony, is that the more one thinks about slavery, the more one reads about it, the more you realize that it's actually very difficult to come up with a definition of slavery that exists across history. So, in fact, I would go so far as to say that there's not really anything that is slavery that applies to every place and every time. So, if you were to go and look at, just look at every society in human history and try and find where there's slavery, or if they have something called slavery that we would translate as slavery to try and define it, it would be very hard to come up with a definition of slavery that applies to everybody. The definitions that are attempted are so vague, it's one group exploiting another group, one group being totally socially debased. Or when you come up with more specific definitions, they actually don't apply to all the things that you want to call slavery. So slavery is a very difficult topic to talk about because in the American context, you see 12 Years a Slave, or you see Roots, or you see even this movie, I remember this period drama called Mansfield Park, which for some reason I saw, where this Jane Austen novel. So there's a scene where the female character, she finds this sketchbook of one of her brothers who's been in the British West Indies, and she sees all these images of slavery and the brutality, and the music kind of, it even has the sound effect of people being whipped and tormented, and the effect on the viewer and the effect on the character are tremendous. And so that's the kind of emotional the emotional experience we have when we think about slavery in the United States today. You know, it's the cardinal sin of American history. And so it's really hard to talk about that in a kind of a detached way. And when we talk about, let's say, slavery in China or slavery in the Ottoman Empire, we think that this sort of what we've seen in these images and we know from our history here in the United States that this applies to other places, but it just doesn't apply. It just does not apply. Our experience with slavery is very specific. And what happens when we go and we kind of apply that to other people and ask other people to answer for that is we're in effect putting our sins on them. I think that's what we're doing. We're offloading our sins onto those people. They might have slavery in China, but until we actually look at it and decide whether it was, you know, what are its good aspects or what are its bad aspects, we really don't have a right to make this immediate moral judgment. Second, you know, when you just think about things like, let's say, ownership, and this is where I think it's really important to think about, you know, what are your moral absolutes, right? So when we talk about slavery in the Western tradition, we think about someone owning another person, we think about somebody being property, we think about somebody losing their choice, we think about somebody being exploited. But what does ownership mean? I mean, what does, you know, in the United States, husbands and wives have ownership rights over each other's person and each other's property, as you discover if you ever get divorced, God forbid. Okay. We have ownership rights over our children in the sense that we control what they do. They don't have rights to make decisions. We have rights over disciplining them physically, even today, let alone 50 years ago. And the fact that we don't talk about ownership in the context of marriage or in the context of children is really just a matter of convention. It's just a matter of what we think is polite. Chinese, up until King Qing China in Imperial China, from the 1600s to 1911, husbands would regularly, in their will, they would say, "And my wife goes to so and so." Their wife was part of their property. She wasn't actually a slave, but she was considered part of their property. So I think that it's really important to ask ourselves the question: what do we mean by property? What do we mean by freedom? What is freedom? I mean, am I free? I have to work, otherwise I'll starve. Am I a free person? If you're in a family and your parents make you feel really guilty if you don't make the choices they want, and they'll ostracize you and make you miserable, and you'll feel guilty and horrible, and your siblings won't talk to you, and everybody you love won't talk to you if you disobey your parents, are you really free to disobey your parents, even if you live in a quote-unquote free society? So I think, are your children free? My children are free people. They're not owned. But their decisions are totally determined by me. So I think that freedom, exploitation, ownership, freedom, these things exist on a spectrum. And it's very hard to tell where on the spectrums what we want to call slavery actually exists. For a lot of slavery in Islamic, even within Islamic history, slavery is extremely diverse. Ottoman Empire was run by slaves. The chief ministers of the Ottoman Empire were all slaves of the Sultan. They were fabulously rich. They were extremely powerful. They married. They had children. They married the daughters of the Sultans. They had children who they passed his privileges on to. And they were all slaves. Whereas the wife of a British slave owner in 1800, that wife had no rights to property. She could be physically disciplined by her husband, and the husband could not even be found legally liable for severely injuring or even killing her under English law. In English law, until the 1870s, even someone who worked for someone else, if you didn't show up for work or if you decided you wanted to leave and break your contract, that was a criminal act. You would go to prison. Was that a free worker? So these people are free, the wife and the worker are free, but the Ottoman minister, the chief of the Ottoman Empire, the wealthiest man in the Ottoman Empire, is a slave. How does this work? I think these we need to be very careful. We can't just say wherever the word slavery appears, or wherever we choose to put that word, suddenly this tremendous moral outrage has to follow. if we want to be outraged by the way people are treated or the way or regimes of exploitation, then by all means, let's be outraged at those regimes of exploitation. But let's not just let's look at the reality, not just the names that are attached to it. I don't know if that answers the question.
So just to ask a follow-up, while it is true, obviously, that slavery is different in different contexts, I think that's an important nuanced point that gets lost. I think it's also important to note that Muslim scholars also justified domestic and agricultural slavery. It wasn't just like the sultan's ministers who were living like their best life in their palaces, and it was like, you know, boys who were mutilated by being castrated. It was like, you know,
mutilated by being castrated
by non-Muslims, then bought by Muslims. It was for a Muslim market, though, or like the slave caravans across the Sahara, and like how difficult that was, and kidnapping primarily children because, you know, it was easier to transport them. Like, I do think there are so many atrocities tied to Muslim slavery in Muslim societies, which are obviously not justified by Islamic theology, but which did exist in Muslim societies, and which were justified by Muslim scholars of the time. So then how we understand moral absolutes when we know that people can turn to the same texts and justify what we see now clearly as atrocities of removing people from their families and for the purpose of having them engage in domestic labor in households primarily, or in military labor.
I mean, I would just say, you know, if you have a regime of law where somebody who has zero economic opportunities and has ready availability of drugs is then going to get arrested for possession of a small amount of drugs and sent to prison, removed from their family, politically disenfranchised, made unemployable, used as slave labor while in prison. By the way, I'm talking about the United States, incidentally. Okay, you know, I mean, I don't have a problem criticizing certain policies, but let's criticize them across the board. I refuse to have Muslims bear the burdens of other society's sins. This is highly objectionable to me. You know, how many even people who talk about modern slavery, do they include the prison industrial complex in this country as part of that? Almost never. So if you want to have discussions, I'm fine having discussions about realities, but I want to have them across the board. If people exploit other people, and by the way, a lot of that is morally acceptable. Someone who's intelligent has the capacity to exploit someone who's not intelligent. Someone who's strong has the capacity to exploit somebody who's weak. You know, our laws in society are designed to limit this so that extreme exploitation doesn't occur, that people have certain rights that if they're infringed, then they have some redress, okay? So I think that, you know, exploitation is not, while we might be uncomfortable about it, I think it's a reality of human life. And as long as it's not extreme, it's part of social reality. Now, in the case of examples of slavery in Islamic civilization, which were egregious examples of exploitation, you know, you point out, agricultural slavery was fairly rare in Islamic civilization. But even then, you know, you have to ask yourself, what's wrong with having agricultural slaves? Is it wrong because we're calling them slaves? What if you took away the title slave? What if you said they are people who are tied to land, have limited right to freedom of movement? They can buy their freedom if they want, if their master agrees, which was allowed in Islamic law. They have to be clothed properly, fed properly, treated properly. And if not, they can go to a court and say, my owner is mistreating me. These are all realities of Islamic civilization. So, you know, we call them slaves, suddenly we're having this really morally kind of compromised discussion. But if we just call them peasants or serfs, then it's not a big deal. I mean, I think that the use of the word slavery in this context is very manipulative. I'm not saying you're being manipulative, but I think we're all being manipulated in this discussion. Now, if people are being, you mentioned kind of the slave trade and bringing, you know, sub-Saharan Africans from the Western sub-Saharan Africa or Western sub-Sahel or what's today Sudan, bringing them into Muslim areas and selling them, and then being, let's say, castrated as eunuchs and then being brought into Islamic lands. I think this was, you know, this was highly problematic. But I think it's also important to keep in mind, and this, I think, pretty true across the board in Islamic intellectual history. I believe that Muslim scholars many of them are often wrong. Sometimes they're always right, but all of them are never wrong, right? And anytime there's an issue where you think, you know, something in my heart tells me there's something wrong here, there's a Muslim scholar making that point 200 years ago, 300 years ago, 1,000 years ago, 1,400 years ago, making that point. So this is famous scholar Ahmed Baba of Timbuktu, died in the early 1615. He writes this treatise on fatwas on slavery, and he says you cannot simply go into areas and capture people because they're quote unquote black and think that they are not Muslims and you can enslave them. And I'm going to tell you who are the tribes that are Muslim and you have to leave them alone, and who are the tribes who are not Muslim. And he himself was enslaved at one point in his life. So he was unhappy. He thought that the Moroccans invaded Timbuktu and they took him away because they thought he was a slave. And so he was extremely, extremely annoyed by this, obviously, to put it lightly. So, you know, he's saying, you can't just go into areas where you think there's a bunch of non-Muslims and raid and accidentally take Muslims. Similarly, in the mid-1000s, Abu Muhammad al-Juvayni, who's the father of Imam al-Haramain al-Juvayni, the famous Shafi scholar who died 1085 Common Era, Abu Muhammad al-Juvayni has a fatwa where he says, taking concubines in this day and age, mind you, he's writing in northeastern Iran in the 1000s, in this day and age, he says, this is unacceptable, it's makruh or prohibited, it's either disliked or prohibited, because we don't know where these people are coming from, and there's too strong a chance that they're Muslim, these slave women. So you point out these abuses or these practices that we could righteously and rightfully condemn as Muslims. But my point is that there's always Muslims who are pointing these out too at the same time. And I think if you go back and you take those voices and you resurrect those voices as our moral voices today, then we don't have a problem speaking from within our tradition.
Okay, so just two follow-up questions. Firstly, how do we know then which voices that we should be picking and building off of? Like, what criteria do we use to pick that? And then secondly, you mentioned that exploitation is morally justifiable unless it becomes extreme, but where do we draw the line and decide it has become extreme?
Wow.
So obviously they don't admit stupid people, Princeton. Well, actually, I'm sure there's some stupid people. Just to be fair, okay? These are good questions. These are very good questions. The first question is, they were so good that I forgot the first one. What was the first one?
The first question was, how do we decide which voices we should be?
Oh, yeah, that's a great question. So this is a big question, because you don't want to get what I call the Franken fatwa. This is my term. Anyone ever hear it? I think I came up with this. I love this term, the Franken fatwa, like Frankenstein. So you say, okay, well, I want to get married. So in the Hanafi school, you know, the main opinion is you don't need the permission of the father of the woman. And then in the Maliki school, there's an opinion you don't need the witnesses. This other school, you know, you don't have to give a dowry. So now you have a marriage with no witnesses, no permission, no dowry. That's Franken fatwa. Nobody would accept that. So there are different approaches that Muslim scholars have come up with for when you can pick and choose from the grab bag. I like to call it the Mr. Potato Head bucket of parts of Islamic tradition. What are the rules for making the Mr. Potato Head? There's three general approaches. One is, and this is a very minority position, which is basically it depends on your intentions. If you intend to do what pleases God, and you pick a certain ruling or you combine different rulings, what matters is your intention. I think that's nice, but it's very naive. The far other extreme is, look, you follow one school of law and you take the main opinion of that school of law, unless there's some necessity. Unless you're in a position of necessity, then you can take an alternative opinion. That's very characteristic of like North African Malikism and South Asian and even Ottoman Hanafism in the early modern period. The middle approach, which is very characteristic of the Shafi'i Hanbali school of law, is that you can pick and choose different opinions. You can, you know, pick from different sources, provided one, that either you have some necessity, or you think that one, you have evidence from the Quran, the Sunnah, that one opinion is better than the other, but you can't have the Franken fatwa. So you can't come up with a result, a compound result, that nobody would accept. I think that's a good approach. And, you know, you don't want to have these situations where, you know, we all get in these situations where you say, okay, I'm going downtown to do some shopping, and then it's time to pray. Well, there's a minority opinion in the Maliki school which says that I can join my true prayers without any rain or danger. I'm just busy right now. Okay? And then you go and you say, there's this, you know, crepe place in the store, and you want to get a crepe, and then you put alcohol in the crepe. And you say, it's okay, well, there's this minority opinion in the Hanafi school which says you can eat the alcohol with the food. Okay? And then you go and you go to the bank and you have, you know, you want to do interest-bearing transactions. Oh, well, there's a minority opinion that says you can do interest-bearing. So basically, at a certain point, you have to ask yourself, what distinguishes you from anybody around you? And I think that's very tempting for Muslims in the West to kind of take these licenses so often that they basically water down their religion to the point of non-recognizability. But I think when we look into the past and on issues that are really morally troubling for us, for example, women leadership in the Muslim community. You know, when you go and you have people saying, you know, Muslim women can't be on the mosque board, she shouldn't even be in the main room of the mosque. We shouldn't have men and women together in this room. That's wrong. Et cetera, et cetera. And then you go back and you look at the time of the Prophet, and you see women getting up in the khutbah and correcting the Umar ibn al-Khattab, as in the Ma'ani al-Thawar of Tahawi, which is considered to be a reliable report. Or you have Aisha, the wife of the Prophet, who's full of political opinions, full of legal opinions. I mean, you see a world in which women are very much involved in political life and are looked to as political beings and as authorities in law. So in that case, you have this moral unease about the exclusion of women from leadership, and then you go back into the Islamic tradition, you see actually, no, this is, we've gone astray. And my moral unease might be caused by the fact that I live in the West where women and men are seen as equal, or at least supposedly. You know, but I'm actually, it's not the West that's making me like this. It's reminding me of something in my own tradition that I'm going back and rediscovering. You know, if I say I'm uneasy with the fact that, you know, some Muslim scholar is telling me that Muslims can just go and take slaves from people, I'm uneasy with that. And then I go back and I look in the past and I see that there are Muslim scholars like Ahmed Bab or Abu Muhammad Jubaini who are saying you can't go and just randomly take slaves This in fact should perhaps even be prohibited because it's so difficult to maintain these conditions that we're supposed to follow that we shouldn't even engage in. Like, that's that. You know, you could say, well, you're just trying to justify condemning condemnation of slavery. Or are you going back and finding a voice that's making authentic argument that happens to agree with the moral unease you feel? So I think it's a question of really being honest with yourself about what's motivating you. Are you seeking to ape others? Or are you using the influence of others, the positive influence of others, to make yourself see the best and most correct part of your own tradition?
And the second follow-up question I had was just, do you know, how do you know when exploitation has gotten so extreme? Because you had mentioned that exploitation, to a certain extent, is inevitable.
Yeah. I mean, first of all, so we know this from fiqh, from Islamic jurisprudence. You have to, hadith from Sahih Bukhari that you're slave. Let's just take the example of slavery. They have to be fed from your food. They have to be dressed from your clothing. They have to be given housing from your housing. You can't give them more work than they can bear. And in Sahih Muslim, a similar hadith, that the clothing, the housing, and the treatment of a slave is done by ma'ruf, what's known to be right at that time and place. So we have here in the Sunnah of the Prophet a clear idea that you should not physically abuse slaves. You can't burden them with more work than they can bear. You have to take care of their feeding, clothing, and housing, but you do so based on what's ma'ruf in your own time and place. So, think about the same issue with children. What is acceptable disciplining for children? Does anybody know what it is in American family law in general? Any guess? In most states, as far as I know, you're allowed to use reasonable force to discipline your child. Reasonably. So what does that mean? Reasonable is whatever people think is reasonable. This actually came up as a debate, I guess it was a year ago or so. There was some guy in the NFL and he hit his kid or something? I don't ever pay attention to sports, but did something happen?
Yeah,
so... I mean, this is actually a really good example of a clash of urfs. These were two American urfs that were clashing. One was as far as I understand, kind of a Southern African American understanding of disciplining, and one was this sort of upper middle class, urban, liberal, white understanding of disciplining, which happens to have a great deal of power. So, even in one country, in one year, you have tremendous disagreement about what appropriate use of force is for disciplining a child. So the same thing could be used for, let's say, disciplining a laborer or disciplining a slave. What's the appropriate way to treat your children in terms of how they're fed, how they're housed? That's very different in different times and places. So I mean, I think where do you draw the lines? In the Islamic tradition, a worker or a slave has to be fed. They have to be clothed, they have to be housed in ways that are similar to the way that a free person is fed, slaved, and has fed, housed, and dressed. And they can be disciplined, but they can't be disciplined in a way that's going to, one, draw blood, that's specific from the hadith of the Prophet. They can't be disciplined in a way that's going to cause any kind of permanent damage, and they can't be killed. Which is actually very similar to the way that you're allowed to discipline your own children. I mean, the rules are almost identical. So in the Islamic tradition, I think they're pretty clear answers. In the Western tradition, I'm not sure what the answers are about when exploitation is justified. I think, by the way, that's one of the tensions in kind of the modern economy over global economy over things like sweatshops. Over things like modern slavery, like bonded labor and things like that, where people point out that American companies engage in labor practices that would not be tolerated in our own country abroad. My wife actually made a documentary about this called Made in Bangladesh on Al Jazeera. I recommend it. It won a Peabody and it got nominated for an Emmy. It didn't win yet. I'd say that I would pose your same question to everybody in the United States. I would say, what do you think the way that the lines are for acceptable exploitation? Because there seems to be a lot of disagreement on that amongst US companies and amongst people who buy products. Why do you guys buy Gap and Old Navy clothes that are made by sweatshop workers in Bangladesh, as my wife's documentary demonstrates?
Okay, so moving into the modern world, what are the implications of assigning moral values to political positions? Because I've heard from a lot of people lately that that's something we shouldn't be doing. But I feel like when you choose a position, you choose it because you think it's correct. So it seems kind of inevitable to me. But then it does seem to be causing a divide between people that's a little bit difficult to bridge. So
this question, I'm sure it's referring to disagreements in the Muslim community. If you think about it, it's very easy to kind of consider any disagreement to be a moral disagreement. With the exception of things like, should I sit on the right side of the chair or the left side of the chair? Or should I drink, Earl Grey tea or Lapsang Soochong tea? That disagreement is not, it's very hard to make that moral disagreement. But all sorts of other things, should you vote yes on a certain initiative or no on a certain initiative? Do you think it's right to support Bernie Sanders or Hillary Clinton or Donald Trump or Ted Cruz or something like that? The second you get into that kind of disagreement, then it's going to get moral very quickly. So I think the problem isn't necessarily trying to make sure that, or trying to avoid seeing a moral dimension to disagreement. I think the question is, what is the range of moral disagreement that we can tolerate and still interact with each other in the community? And again, here it's very, I think it's useful to keep in mind the Islamic tradition, where you have incredible diversity between Sunnis and Shiites. Within Sunni Islam, you have four schools of law, three different schools of theology. And the position in general, especially amongst the schools of law, was, I think my school of law is correct with the possibility that it's wrong. I think the other schools of law are wrong with the possibility that they're correct. But they're all Sunnis, and beyond that, we're all Muslims. So, I think the Islamic tradition is actually a paragon of unity and diversity, or diversity within unity. And I think that Muslims were able to do that because they understood that, first of all, the companions of the Prophet disagreed with each other, and they were all the best generation, therefore even the best of people were going to disagree with each other. In fact, even the best people might even get into physical fights with each other. In fact, they might even make war on each other. And yet they still, every year, they would come to Mecca and do Hajj together. I mean, that's a very interesting thing. Every year Hajj happened. Every single year Hajj happened. There's a great hadith in Sahih Bukhari in the Kitab al-Fitan that talks about these two companions who are on opposing sides of this sort of first civil war, the Sunni-Shiite divide starts. And they're getting this heated debate, and then the prayer time comes and they both get up and they go and pray. The fact that in Sunni Islam at least, you can despise a ruler. That ruler can be a bloodthirsty, wine-swilling, fornicating, innocent person-killing, greedy bastard. But if he gets up and leads the prayer, then in Sunni Islam, the principle is we pray behind everybody, bir al fajr, righteous or unrighteous. And for example, I hate the Egyptian government. I hate the Egyptian government with extreme passion. Yeah, I think it's a disastrous, kitschy, horrendous, aesthetically revolting and morally revolting regime. Now, but if, and I, it's hard for me to say, if Abdul Fattah al-Sisi came in here and was going to lead the prayer, I would pray behind him. And I don't like that idea, but that's what I have to do as a Sunni Muslim. So Sunni Islam is this, I think, I mean, and I have no problem talking about the virtues and positive attributes of other Islamic schools of sects as well. But I'm just here and just talking about Sunnism. It is a perspective on the world that recognizes that disagreement is part and parcel of life, and that disagreement might be intense, and that disagreement might be violent, but it cannot be allowed to trump I gotta get a good word for that. To supersede the shared communal boundary or the shared communal identity, or to break those bonds. So, you know, when it comes to kind of political issues, let's say for American Muslims, I mean, I wrote something about this maybe a week or two ago for a Medina Institute, where we have to have the most patience with each other as possible. We have to have the biggest tent as possible, the largest tent possible. We need to make as many excuses for people as possible. So, for example, if I say, you know, I forget her name.
Zina,
I want you to sign this petition for this really important cause. And you say, I don't really feel like it. My policy is, okay, you know what, that's fine. Because people don't have endless emotional energy, and they can't be involved in everything, and they can't stand up for everything. You know, they have a finite amount of energy, of outrage, of anger, of emotion. And also sometimes people just don't want to get involved, sometimes they don't have the luxury to get involved. Okay, so my principle is, as long as you're not harming my cause, I'm not going to hold this against you. I'm not going to consider it a moral fault of yours. That's my principle. Now, if we're having a boycott, if it's, let's say, a very successful boycott of a certain country which happens to have apartheid policies and, engage in 19th century settler colonialism in the 21st century, under the full protection of the United States government and American taxpayers for some reason. Let's say there was a country like that. Let's say there's a very successful international boycott, divestment, and sanction movement against that country, which has gotten, as my last count, 5 or 6 standalone articles in The Economist devoted to it in the past 5 years, and which has gotten the full support of the civil society of said oppressed economy, of said oppressed people, and they've asked the international community to support them in this boycott, divestment, and sanction movement. And if American Muslims have for generations supported this idea and not even considered the idea of, let's say, going to visit a certain country on the tab of an institution from a certain country, which happens to be an extremist, apartheid supporting institution, right? I can't remember where I was going. My point is, if we imagine such a situation, and then an American Muslim decides to go on that trip, even though all sorts of Christians and Jews and Buddhists and atheists and rock stars and non-rock stars and scientists like Stephen Hawking and non-scientists are supporting this boycott effort. At that point, if a Muslim chooses to break that boycott, I consider that to be a fault on their part because they are harming my cause. I don't know if that makes any sense. But my point is, you know, just another example. If, you know, we can sit around and we can criticize, we can criticize, let's say, President Trump. President Trump is terrible. President Trump did this. President Trump said this. I have to get used to saying this. President Trump said this. President Trump said that. But if President Trump says, I want some Muslim scholars, I don't know if that's a good invitation. I don't even know. Maybe it's like almost like Bernie Sanders impersonation. I don't even know. I have to work on a Trump impersonation. So he says, I want Muslim scholars to come and meet with me. Tell me about this American Muslim community. I want them to tell me about Islam. Okay? Let's say he does that. I don't know. You know, if a bunch of Muslim scholars go and meet with President Trump, I'm fine with that. Provided that they believe, and it's we all believe that there's the benefit that can come from that is better than the harm or greater than the harm. Yeah, so I think it's very, by the way, I want to be clear. I think it's wrong to engage in this sort of knee-jerk contact, contact contagion politics where you say, oh, how dare Zenit be on the stage with Jonathan Brown? Because Jonathan Brown said this, therefore Zenit shouldn't have been on the same stage. Oh, how dare Jonathan Brown meet with Imam Suhaib? Because Imam Suhaib said this once. No, that's impossible. Human relations become impossible at that point. People have to be able to interact with other human beings, even if the ones they disagree with. So I think actually we should be very reserved about kind of heaping moral criticism on fellow Muslims in the United States. We should make excuses for them, but I think we also have to have certain red lines. When people are harming causes that are agreed upon or at least enjoy tremendous support within the Muslim community, then that I think is crossing the line.
Thank you. Okay, I have one more question and we'll open it up to audience Q&A. So my final question is about social justice and activism, especially because I'm involved with MSJID, which is Muslim Advocates for Social Justice and Individual Dignity.
Very clever acronym.
We did come up with that acronym first. But so yeah, when engaging with social justice and activism, where do we draw the line between preserving our own values and engaging in coalition building, both in terms of like the character and methodology of the way people want to act in these coalitions and in terms of the actual morals that we're standing for?
So you have a lot more courage than I did when I was in college. I don't think I did a single thing in college except study. I never had to. I don't know if I had the time. I think I was always afraid, I'll be honest. I think I was always afraid to do this sort of stuff. So I really applaud people who do it. And it makes me think that the generation of Muslims in college today better than the ones when I was in college, at least better than I was. It's sort of, Muslims have had this question for the past 15 or, let's say 20 years. Do we kind of become Republicans and join the Republicans because we all kind of are socially conservative and things like that? And then 9/11 happened, and then Patriot Act got passed, and then we found out that apparently a lot of conservative Christians in this country think we are a cancer that has to be excised from the country. And so that didn't really work. Conservatives in this country, they, with the exception of very intelligent and wise people like Robert George, I wish there were more people like him, but sadly, he's a minority in the conservative movement in this country. What seems to be the majority don't see the value in Muslims and Islam. I think that's a tremendous loss. So conservatives would want us to give up both our political views and, in effect, our religious views. Because although we are socially conservative and believe in God, we also have a notion of family that is completely reprehensible to conservative Christianity. It's important to keep this in mind. Just the possibility of polygamy made Muslim marriages invalid in English law until the early 20th century. Unless those Muslim marriages were carried out in a Muslim country and then the person came to it. But if it was done in England or outside of a Muslim country, that the potential of polygamy made it invalid. Now, what about this sort of sense, then Muslims, after this, Muslims realize, okay, the only people who are going to work with us are the Democrat Party. Okay. Unfortunately, the kind of centrist Democrats want you to give up your political views and your social views because, let's say, being opposed to same-sex marriage or being opposed to kind of a lot of elements on the LGBTQ agenda, this would make you kind of persona non grata in the centrist Democratic Party. And your political views, let's say on Palestine or on US foreign policy abroad, are also unacceptable. So then the only place left on the spectrum is the progressive left. They will accept your political views. My wife always, there's a show called Transparent or something. Is it called Transparent? Jeffrey Tambor is in it, and And then, you know, she says there's a scene where he's at some, I guess he's a transgender guy, and he goes, he's at some protest, and someone's like, "Free Palestine!" In the scene, she remembers that when she was advocating for family members who were accused of different things, she remembers that the only, she would go to these socialist meetings, and there would be like the couple only person place where you'd see like Palestinian flags for these meetings. So the progressive left will accept our political agenda because they see apartheid, settler colonialism is unacceptable. They see American militarism is unacceptable. They see foreign intervention, which leads to massive civilian death for the profit of American corporations, as unacceptable. But the question is, what do they say about our social values? I think that's the big question that I see behind what you're asking. And there's the rub. And here you have in the kind of the current manifestation of this question is, do Muslims support Black Lives Matter? Because one, we think it's absolutely unacceptable that Black males are being shot for absolutely no reason by the police constantly. And no one seems to be paying any price for that or being held accountable. But also because they're willing to support us. They see also that Muslims, that Muslim lives matter. And that our legal rights need to be protected as well. But do we support them because at the same time, let's say people in the Black Lives Matter movement will call for transgender rights or LGBT rights or gay rights or something like that. And a lot of Muslims don't agree with that. So here's the question. If an activist organization accepts that I personally don't agree with a certain, let's say, lifestyle, that I consider this lifestyle in my religion to be impermissible, but I'm completely willing to support them in their work, and they're completely willing to support me in my work, and I will go and advocate for their rights to have a marriage that is free of Western Christian biases, and they will advocate for my right to have a marriage which is free of Western Christian biases, my Sharia marriage with my wife, I don't see any problem working together with them. I think I don't approve of their lifestyle, but you know what? They don't approve of my religion. I mean, this is, I think we tend to forget this. You know, like my family are all non-Muslims, okay? They're atheists. They think if you believe in God, you're kind of an idiot. And if you believe in Islam, then you're a big idiot. And I'm around them all the time. Do I get upset and say, you need to affirm my beliefs? No, that would be ridiculous. No one would even conceive of asking that. Similarly, we shouldn't be asked to morally approve of everything everyone else does in order to work with them. If you kind of generalize that into society, society would become unmanageable. Because we're always constantly around people, part of whose lives or part of whose identities or some of whose values we disagree with deeply. But we still function with them professionally and even on a personal level. So I'd say I have no problem, and I encourage coalition building with progressive groups or, you know, kind of left progressive groups, even if they have views that you really disagree with. And there may come a time when someone will say to you, I want you to affirm morally what I do, my lifestyle. And if they're not okay with you saying, no, I don't morally affirm it, then that partnership shouldn't continue. But my hunch is they're not gonna ask that. I mean, people I don't know, I always want to ask Glenn Greenwald this question, because I have a lot of respect for him. But my sense is someone like Glenn Greenwald, who understands that part of the beauty of the American constitutional system is that people don't have to morally agree with each other in order to protect each other's rights. My sense is someone like him would not have a problem working with people who actually didn't approve of each other's lifestyle.
Thank you so much for answering my questions. So at this time, we're just gonna open it up to whoever else would like to ask a question.
You guys exhausted?
Sorry.
It's okay. And we have about 15 minutes or so.
I'll be quick in my answers.
Yeah, and maybe we can take two questions at a time. And can we begin with students? If students have questions for us, we'll start there.
I'm not technically a Princeton student.
She had her hand up, though.
A
medical student.
So my question is on upon this last answer that you just gave regarding not even specifically the coalitions of others, but this has always been a topic that has confused me, of behavior that is unacceptable in a scale if it's conducted by those around you. Like, what is the fic of, I know you just said it, but it's almost kind of still unbelievable to me to sort of say, okay, like, my American friend drinks, and you don't, like, encourage them to drink. You kind of see what I'm getting at? Like, the quote-unquote bad behavior.
Mm-hmm.
Are you okay with it, and is being okay with it problematic? Or?
Good question.
We'll take one more, and yeah, maybe.
My question is the relationship between ignorance and pluralism, and that to what extent should we be attempting to kind of like get rid of ignorance, and to what extent should we be adopting like the locum bene locum moveandi, like to each his own sort of mindset?
What do you mean by ignorance?
So when you have a pluralistic society, you have a lot of people who like have different opinions on things. So for example, within the Muslim community, there are people who staunchly supported Hillary Clinton from like her primary run. And then I, for example, have more reservations about her foreign policy or about other things about her campaign or her as a politician. And so to what extent is it like that in a pluralistic society, we should also be attempting to like educate others? And that's something that's been on the minds of a lot of people following the election results, is like, should we be bridging the gap between, you know, like differing mindsets? And to what extent should it be that like, okay, that's their own opinion. We're in a pluralistic society, they can have their opinion. They occupy a specific group with a specific mindset about something,
mm-hmm.
and I don't have to necessarily always be engaging with that.
I mean, these two questions are very closely related. I'll try and answer them. So, first of all, the two things, your ignorance and education, are not mutually exclusive. So, you know, I think the answer is clearly that Muslims have a duty to do amr bil ma'ruf wa nahi anil munkar, to enjoin right and forbid wrong. Okay. But we're supposed to do adfa bilati hi ahsan wa adu rasbil rabbikum bil hikmati wa mawdhal hasana. So we call to the path here by wisdom and goodly preaching and push back with what is better. Now that's a tactical injunction in the sense that the idea of your friends drinking, for example. Now, I think Muslims have an obligation to tell your friend at some point and in some way, I think drinking alcohol is bad. Or to tell your friend, you know, Hillary Clinton never saw a war she didn't like. Right? and she like seemingly doesn't mind killing a lot of Muslims, et cetera, et cetera. But it's all about how you do it. If every time your friend's drinking, you say, you should not drink, this is haram, you know, then they're going to get annoyed at you. If you harp constantly about this issue, it's not going to achieve the intended result, and it's going to drive the person away. So I think it's a question of how you do it. You know, you wait for the time when you're really having a discussion about this issue to tell your friend what you think about drinking alcohol. You know, you don't tell them right before they're going to go out and have a good time, they think a good time with their friends. So I think, you know, here it's not a question of principle. The principle is clear. It's about choice of when and how and means and method. Is that clear? The issue you ask about, you know, how Muslims' ability to put up with things, I actually wrote this, I want to say article. I think it's an article, but it's pretty well-researched. I spent a lot of time researching it. Called, what is it called? Like, how much can Muslims stomach? I like the title. So it's about, I talk about immediate family incest and Hindu widow immolation. So Muslim scholars, it seems to be Muslim scholars and Muslim rulers in South Asia allowed Hindu widows to throw themselves on the pyre of their dead husbands, sati, provided that they got permission from the governor, the Muslim governor, and that they were not forced to do it. So if they wanted to do this, Muslim rulers were like, okay. Oh, and Muslim rulers also, and governors also tried to convince them not to. They'd say, well, we'll give you a stipend, even though you're a widow, we'll give your children stipends. Mm-hmm. But if the person really wanted to do it, they're okay, go ahead. the British banned something in 1829, and the American, I think it's the Reynolds or Davis decision in 1879 or 1890, I can't remember which Supreme Court decision, but the judge writing the decision actually uses Hindu wife immolation, widow immolation, as an example of why governments have to interfere in religion, in religious beliefs. Like, this was so unacceptable to Americans, to American law, that this was an instance, that the kind of the textbook example of when a government has to say you can't allow people to follow their religion. In both, so the Muslim Islamic law is more tolerant than both British and American law. That's what I think is this big irony. Muslims are always shown to be intolerant. In fact, Islamic law is supremely tolerant. Immediate family incest in Zoroastrian law until the 14th century, it was permitted to have immediate family incest marriages between father, daughter, mother, son, and brother, sister. It was extremely rare, which is very interesting. The majority position of Muslim scholars was that Muslims would permit Zoroastrians living under Muslim rule to engage in immediate family incest. That was the majority position. Why? Because this is part of their religion. That's part of their religion.
So we can't impose our...
This was the ultimate argument. The ultimate argument is, the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet have shown, without a doubt, that Muslims are commanded to allow non-Muslims to continue practicing their religion under Muslim protection. We are commanded to indulge their practice of their religion, even though they believe things that are completely unacceptable, even though they deny our belief in our religion, they deny the prophecy of Muhammad, they deny all sorts of things that are absolutely fundamental to Islam. Actually, the argument of Muslim scholars was, there's nothing worse than kufr, there's nothing worse than unbelief. And if you're going to allow unbelief, and it's the worst thing, then what justification do you have for banning? Like, immediate family incest is disgusting. In fact, it's one of the few universal, almost universal human taboos that basically every society agrees on. But they said this is not as bad as kufr. Now, and someone would say, okay, well then, do you allow people to commit murder or do human sacrifice? No, because of hukuk al-ibad. People have rights. Every human being has certain rights. And just so you think I'm not trying to shoehorn human rights into Islam here, haq means right. Hukuk means rights. Ibad means slaves of God, like people. So it means literally the rights of the slaves of God, i.e. human beings. You do not, a human being does not have a right to kill another human being without reason. So that's why with sati, with Hindu widow immolation, Muslims only allowed it if the woman demonstrated she wanted to do it. And they prohibited forced immolation. So that's why we Muslims can allow immediate family incest marriage, but they wouldn't allow, let's say, human sacrifice in a religion, even if it's part of someone's religion. That's why, for example, although later in Islamic civilization Muslims allowed riba, the Prophet, in one of the treaties we have, which is actually, even non-Muslim scholars think it's probably authentic, very early treaty, the treaty that the Prophet had with the people, the Christians of Najran. Najran is right now on the Saudi-Yemeni border, southern Arabia. He allowed them to continue practicing Christianity. He said, we won't mess with you at all. You pay a certain tax to us, and you also cannot have riba. You can't do interest. Because that was seen as violating the rights of others to not be exploited.
We'll take two more questions. Amir?
I'm fine, you
can go. Okay.
That guy had a question. Go first? Okay, so a common scenario that Muslims would face in the West is we want to build a mosque and face opposition, and maybe a Christian or Jew asks us, would I be allowed to build a church or synagogue in Muslim countries? How do you respond to that?
Mm-hmm. Other questions?
My question was sort of going back to your last point before you ended with Zina, in terms of coalition building, and my question is on, like, I guess complete reciprocity of what, like, they will give you, and whether you should be, or whether it, we should hold ourselves to being, like, entirely reciprocal. So, you know, for example, like when it comes to LGBTQ people, right? Like we can coalition build on things that are common goals to all of us. Like, for example, you know, coalition build against, like, you know, Trump's rhetoric, because that affects both of us. But then, for example, when it comes to Islamophobia, a lot of times the LGBTQI community will come very directly to our support and, you know, in, like, our rallies and stuff, you know, for example, or we don't really have rallies, but, you know, anything really. But then is it our obligation to also reciprocate in the same manner, for example, attend, and I'm sort of asking from, you know, a, I guess, you know, classical Islamic framework. I know that there's different opinions, but is it our duty to reciprocate in the same way, and also, and, you know, what do we have to support and what don't we have to support?
Okay, so two very good questions. The answer to this is easy. So the fiqh in Islamic history on houses of worship of non-Muslims under Muslim rule is extremely broad. You find a lot of different opinions. So the kind of Shafi opinion is, let's just say, like, you know, churches and mosques, or churches and synagogues, are places where kufr happens, shirk happens. You can't encourage that. Whereas the Hanafi position is, no, the Quran says these are, you know, bay'un wa sawamihu masajidu wa salatun yudhkaru fiya ismallah, right? Yudhkaru fiya ismallah. I think that's the, I didn't give the verse exactly, but those are the places that are mentioned. Synagogues, churches, temples, and mosques. These are places where God's name is mentioned. In the Hanafi tradition, they say, look, these are, people might have disagreements about, you know, important details, but God's name is being honored in these places, so they have to protect it. So there's just, even at the basic interpretive level of the Quran, there's disagreement about which direction you go. And then if you look at even the companion opinions, successor opinions, the opinion of Ibn Abbas, which becomes the kind of, and Ibn Omar ibn Abdulaziz, which becomes the main opinion in Sunni Islam, is that churches and synagogues new ones cannot be built in Muslim cities, but existing ones are fine. And if you have non-Muslims living in their own area, they can build their own mosques and build their own churches and stuff like that. That's fine. And this, I think, and this really became the practical opinion which was adopted, which was, if Christians and Jews were living in an area which was inhabited by Muslims, like they're all mixed up together, then Christians and Jews were generally not allowed to build new churches and synagogues. They were not allowed to have public processions with the crosses. They were not allowed to have, they didn't have church bells, but these wooden clackers that they would use instead of church bells. But if they were in, like, another area, they could have church bells, they could build new churches, they could build new synagogues, they could have pig markets, they could have booze markets, whatever, because this was in their own area. In fact, even the rule that in a Muslim city you couldn't have churches and synagogues, that wasn't actually followed, because Baghdad was a city built by Muslims, a totally new city, and in it there were all these churches and synagogues. In fact, at one point, Muslims were squatting in this monastery, and the monks went to the caliph, I think it was Al-Mansur at the time, and complained, and he kicked them out. He said, okay, you guys got to get out. Muslims, you got to get out. This is their monastery. So and another important point is that it depends on the negotiations. How was an area conquered? So when Muslims moved into an area, if they signed a peace treaty or came to an agreement, which is the majority, most cases, with the Jewish, Hindu, whatever local population, if they said, you guys can do this, you know, the agreement, that was what carried the day, not some rule about no church and mosque. That's why when Muslims went into India in 711, what's called the Brahmanabad Compact, they treated the Hindus like people of the book. In fact, even the upper class of the Hindus, the Brahmins, were exempt from jizya. That was part of the agreement. So when someone says that point to me, I say, yeah, sure, why not? I have no problem. I could easily go back and give you all sorts of authoritative precedents from Islamic law and history that shows that Muslims allowed non-Muslims to build places of worship in under Muslim rule. Now, if there's some country that has an extremely prohibitive ruling on that, that's not my problem. Go talk to the people from that country and debate with them. And if you want me to write a letter criticizing them, I'm happy to. But that's not my problem. I don't answer for the policies of specific Muslim countries. And then someone else, your question about... So I think, I'm not an activist. Well, I don't know what the hell I am. But I'm definitely not an effective activist. And I'm not a community organizer, because I barely leave my house. But what I would say is, I would ask myself this question. What am I supporting? So let's say there's, what might prompt a rally for LGBTQ issues? Something hateful has been written on the spray painted on the wall. Die, go home, or die, tranny, or something like that. I don't know. Or there's an attack on somebody. I mean, what are the, these are examples. These are the type of things that happen, right? Or Donald Trump says something. President Trump says something. What are you supporting? Are you saying, I support these people's lifestyle and their values, that's why I'm upset? Or are you saying, I support the right of citizens in this country to go about their daily business without molestation, without egregious offense, without physical harm, without physical intimidation, not being threatened by their public officials? Yeah, I have no problem supporting that. Because guess what? That's exactly what I want as a Muslim. It's exactly what I want as a Muslim. And I know there's lots of people out there who don't approve of the way I dress, they don't approve of what I believe, they don't approve of things that I do in my daily life. But if they're willing to come out and protest for my protection and my right to live at peace, then I'm going to do it for them. Because I also agree with these things. So I think the question is, how do you phrase this in your own mind? I'm not trying to say how do you justify it. My question to you is, how did you understand it?
So we'll take one final question.
Yes.
And then we'll close. Yeah.
Okay. I thank you for this very wide-ranging discussion. And yes, I'm sure you're exhausted. I'm happy you pointed out the value of history, of knowing history, of all these times and limitations on how rules are interpreted at various times. I'd like to share just one interpretation that was very interesting. I found very interesting that the Khalifa Umar ibn Khattab once displaced fired a governor just because he was asking too much of the people. He was asking for more what the people can take. Mm-hmm. So in a way, it's a study in itself of what are what limitations was he pushing, what was he, what did he see, and what if this becomes a general that rulers cannot ask or push people around for more what they can handle or what they can take. So that would be a different right concept right there, political right concept. My question is, because in many ways one has to learn a lot of history in order to differentiate what is the ethical content and norms or what is the religious versus what is in fact political and has been common under so many political, economical, cultural, that was common among many societies for that period of time. That wasn't, so one has to compare Islam to many other societies. But the question is basically, from your knowledge of the hadith, where are some of the injunctions or about self-criticism? For instance, in the Middle East, men can criticize women as much as they like, but they don't look at themselves and say, here, I should be critical of this. Are there some rules of being self-critical? Because slavery can be interpreted many ways and has been ideologically interpreted many ways for either to blame the Arabs, to blame the Jews, to blame somebody who was the slave owner versus, you know, or merchant, or, you know, so slavery was kind of used in such multiplicity of ways. And so how can we criticize, you know, that very real notion that, yes, slavery was a certain period of history, and freedom is still a long way to go for all societies concerned in a way. But this kind of, I know, for instance, philosophy in Christianity, know thyself, you know, to thine own self be true.
Internal
Islam,
criticism.
What would
so you're asking about what's the point? Yeah, I mean, I think that... you know, in the surahs of Qiyamah, I think there's this notion of a nafs al-lawwama, the self-reproaching, self-reproaching soul, I think is how. Where does the study come in? The self-reproaching soul.
Yeah,
this is a core job of a Muslim,
mm-hmm.
you know, and of a thoughtful, conscientious person, is to constantly be interrogating themselves. What is it that I really want? What am I? You know, I think it's funny when we talk about, someone says, writes a book about, let's say some guy lived in 1200, and they say, you know, why did this guy do this and that? They base it on, you know, one snippet here and one snippet there. And for God's sake, we don't even know why we do stuff,
mm-hmm.
let alone why some other person does stuff that we, when we can talk to them, let alone someone who's been dead at 800 years, we have very limited information about. So I think, you know, the complexity of human motivation is really important to keep in mind. And so for us, the reason it's important is we have to constantly ask God to purify our intentions and ask yourself, what is my intention? Why am I doing this? Why am I doing this? But at the same time, you don't want this to become paralyzing. We were talking about anthropologists today, and like, you know, the sort of reflexive positionality and stuff becomes incapacitating, and eventually you just sort of end up going and studying a bunch of ants or something because you feel so guilty about looking at any other human being. So it can't become paralyzing. So, you know, you ask God to purify your intentions. You do your best to ask Him, why am I doing this? Could it be for this reason? Could it be for that reason? Don't be afraid to look at and explore the dark corners of your soul. This is very important for me. I mean, I think for everyone, this is really important for my own views. And when I write books and stuff, or if I take positions on something, sometimes in my life, I had a position on something, and then I looked deep inside me, and I said, I think this is because you're greedy. You're afraid of losing something. You're afraid of losing power. You're afraid of losing privilege. And when you have those moments of realization, they're very liberating, because you become free of this manacle that was inside you on your heart. And so it's very important to do that, I agree. And then once you ask yourself as sincerely as you can, you go ahead. I think it was Davy Crockett who said, first make sure you're right, then go ahead.
I think that's a great place to end.
Davy Crockett, folks.
I want to thank you, Dr. Jackson, and Dr.
That's
wow.
Great. I'm elevated to elder statesman status.
Dr. Jonathan Brown. See, the conversation was so engaging.
Yeah,
we've got
I'm
names.
Not gonna,
and we've all become one. But we really do want to thank you, not only for coming, but for your patience in answering the questions. And, you know, I think that... a lot of what you had to offer was food for thought, and I can tell, like, just by everybody sticking around wanting more, that we really appreciate your time here. I want to thank Zina for her great
mm-hmm.
questions, her prodding questions, you know, and for really representing Princeton.
Yeah,
well,
good job.
And we want to invite you to our next event. Unfortunately, if you have the list of events that we have, there's a conversation that was supposed to happen on Islam and atheism, and we were really looking forward to that. The scholar who is coming, actually all the way from the UK, his, something happened with his visa, he wasn't able to make it. So hopefully we'll reschedule that in the spring or some other time. But the next event that we do have is on December 1st, and it's actually a majlis that is going to be a majlis of the Shia community, and it's a majlis that everyone's invited to observe or participate in as you feel comfortable.
Right.
And if you are a Sunni or you're not somebody who's Shia, and you have always wondered what do these Shia gatherings look like, where they come and they commemorate the life and the martyrdom of Hussein, may God be pleased with him, this is your opportunity, and we're going to make it a very open and ecumenical space to do that. It's going to be right here at 7 p.m. on Thursday, December 1st, speaking of pluralism. I hope you can all make it. And then we have an event with Alam Rabbit, who's known as the Doogie Howser of the Middle East. Doogie Howser was the show back in the 80s. But it's about this young medical doctor. She's, mashallah, in her early 20s, and she's a medical doctor, but she's also a human rights advocate, and she's a she's somebody who works for the UN in terms of on public health around the world, and she was also a voice in the Libyan revolution. Very, very awesome individual, and so she'll be coming in December, and so please look out for that conversation as well.
Sign up for the email list, grab
please,
a mug.
Please join the
yeah.
email list, and if you don't already have a Muslim Life program mug, please take a mug so you can remember us as you sip your tea. And please keep us in your prayers, and look forward to seeing you soon. Thank you.